Our speakers today are, in order of speaking, Dr. Richard Sean Faulkner, who is a professor of military history of the United States Army Command and General Staff College in Fort Leavenworth. He served 23 years in the U.S. Army as an Army Armor Officer. He earned his doctorate in American history from Kansas State University. He is the author of two books and the winner of both the Tomlinson Book Prize and the Society for Military History's Distinguished Book Award. He'll be followed by Dr. Scott Stephenson, who is Professor Emeritus of Military History at the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College. His research focuses on the German Empire and its downfall. He is a Tomlinson Book Award winner for his work, The Final Battle, and a graduate of the United States Military Academy at West Point. He served for 25 years as an Army officer, and please, would you join me in congratulating him on his retirement on Monday? From almost 30 years as faculty at the Command and General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth, and Dr. Vanda Wilcox, who is a historian of Italy in the early 20th century with interests in military, colonial, and cultural history. Since earning her doctorate at the University of Oxford, she has authored three books and today is joining us from Milan, where she is working as an independent researcher and researching a new history of Italian imperialism in the 19th and 20th centuries. Y'all, I'm so excited for this panel. Will you please join me in welcoming to the stage Dr. Richard Sean Faulkner.
Now, as always, it's a great pleasure to be here on the stage again. And what compounds this is the fact that I'm going to be joined on the stage by Dr. Scott Stephenson. Now, Scott and I go way back. We've taught together for 20 years. And when he left on Monday, his loss has already been felt. So, Scott, good luck as we go on, and I'll continue to drag you into the World War I Museum for presentations as we go forward. Now, I didn't tell Laura that Scott and I actually worked to sabotage the last speaker so we could bogart more time, which hopefully won't be necessary. Next slide, please. So, part of the panel is to discuss the veteran citizens. In my case, I'll be talking about the doughboys when they came home and what the war meant to their citizenship in the interwar period. But to discuss this, we actually have to go further back in American history. The founders, from the very beginning of the Republic, sort of enshrined that service in the military in times of danger was an obligation of citizenship. It was a civic virtue to serve. In fact, in one of the first pieces of legislation the new Constitutional Congress passed, in 1792, they passed the Calling Forth Act, and that act required all able-bodied white males between the ages of 18 and 45 to serve in the militia in times of war or civil disturbance. So on one hand, we've got this tradition of obligations of citizenship. On the other hand, the veterans themselves will craft their own ideas of obligation. And sometimes these are going to be at odds. To the veterans, starting with the American Revolution, they would argue that since they are protecting the Republic and the people therein, and they have sacrificed, that they are also owed an obligation from the federal government for that time and service. Now, these two conflicting ideas we're going to see through the rest of my presentation. The veterans issue itself, though, from the establishment of the Constitution and the Civil War, was relatively dormant. You could easily fob off the veterans with minute payments or promises of land grants. That all changes in the American Civil War. The scope, the scale, the sacrifice creates a new mindset in these hundreds of thousands of veterans and their survivors. One of the most influential lobbying group in American history is the Grand Army of the Republic, a fraternal organization of Union veterans, but then quickly becomes a political group. Not only are they successful in lobbying to get their people elected to highest forms of leadership within the Republic, they also are effective in using that political power to further their demands for compensation. They are so successful, in fact, that in 1889, a third of the federal budget goes to Union Army pensions alone. Now, Their coup, though, will happen in the next year, 1890, when under the pressure of the GAR, the Congress will pass an act that enables any Union veteran that had served only 90 days on active duty during the war, if they were disabled at any other point in time in their life to the point that they could no longer do manual labor, even if that disability had absolutely nothing to do with the war, they would also receive a pension. Now, by the time you get to the turn of the century, though, a new generation of politicians and citizens are coming to believe that perhaps the Republic had been overly generous with the veterans. Next slide, please. That takes us to the war itself. The Wilson administration is going to decisively break with the traditions that had gone in the past. One of the most important, for the first time in American history, the vast majority of American soldiers, over 70%, will now be raised through conscription. Now, Wilson falls back on this. Thank you. My mistake. Wilson falls back on this with the same argument that the founders made. The state can require you to serve as an obligation of citizenship. At the same time, the Wilson administration recognized, though, that if you're going to force American citizens to serve and to put themselves at risk of life or limb, the government actually owes these veterans something. Now, their solution to this, though, is actually quite brilliant and fits in well with the progressive ideology. Despite the fact that World War I is exceptionally bloody, the Wilson administration realizes that the vast majority of American soldiers will not be killed or disabled in the war. So the War Risk Insurance Act is to take massive servicemen group life insurance, met it together with a little bit of subsidy from the federal government. Those doughboys who are not killed and wounded will ultimately pay for the compensation of those who were. Now, this is to try to avoid that trap of the Civil War generation. The Wilson administration hopes and plans that if this system works, when the war is over, the government's debt to its citizens will be paid in full. There'll be no more requests for pensions on the backside. The doughboys, however, had different ideas, and were quick to not only reassert the full rights of a civil citizen, but also the full rights as a veteran. I love this letter that Private Russell writes back to his father just a week after the armistice. You've got the potential of 4 million veterans now voting as a bloc. And these guys are quick to use that power. In fact, in the winter of 1918-1919, congressmen and senators are inundated by letters from serving soldiers demanding that they get released from the service to return to civil life. Now, one of the first politicians to recognize that something is changing with this new veterans generation was Senator George Chamberlain. And I love this quote. "These men are going to have their own say in politics. When the doughboys returned and were demobilized, they were not necessarily happy with the treatment that they had been received at the hands of the Army during the war. And these new veterans are going to use their political clout to force investigations into the conduct of the war." Chamberlain himself will leave one of the most influential. He will investigate the abuses of the military justice system during the war. And that scares the Army so much that all of the JAG Corps lawyers descend upon Chamberlain's office to hash out a compromise to keep the reforms from going too far. The most important consideration the doughboys have, though, is how are they going to reintegrate back into American society? Now, this is going to be a challenge. The Wilson administration had anticipated that the war was going to go into 1919, if not 1920. They are so consumed with mobilizing the force, they've given no thought to how they're going to demobilize the home front and demobilize the soldiers. What they end up doing is panicking. And so the week after the armistice, the phone lines from the Navy and War Departments are buzzing as they precipitously cancel defense contracts. Now, there are 9 million defense workers during World War I. And because of these actions, several hundreds of thousands of them are going to be released back into an already tight job market. Added to that, of course, you're going to have 4 million more demobilized soldiers. So unemployment is the number one concern of the soldiers. Now, under political pressure from friends and allies and the soldiers themselves, the administration has to admit that they need to give the soldiers something at the end of their service. So while they're saying they're going to be paid in full, they have to renege. But they're not being very generous. At demobilization, the doughboys are given a $60 one-time bonus. Now, in today's money, that's between $900 and $1,000. Now, that might sound like a nice little nest egg, but we got to consider that at the time, the U.S. government was undergoing some major doldrums. While during the war, the United States goes from being a debtor nation to a creditor nation, and there are people making money hand over fist, rising inflation is undercutting the ability of soldiers and workers to actually benefit from that. In fact, the 1919 dollar is worth only 45 cents of the 1913 dollar. And during that same time period, something we can all admit to or recognize, the cost of living increased by 99%. So these doughboys are worried about the economy, but they're also concerned about the republic that they return to. 1919 is going to be one of the most tumultuous years in American history. During that year alone, there are over 3,600 labor strikes that take out 4 million workers. These strikes, in conjunction with a series of bombings that occur by leftist organizations in the summer, spring and summer of 1919, convince a number of Americans, and more importantly, a number of returning American soldiers, that the United States might be on the brink of a Bolshevik revolution. Now, I'm going to take exception to some of the stuff that Dr. Alexander said from the point of the doughboys themselves. The doughboys, having seen Europe and rejected most of what they saw in Europe, come back home with an inflated sense of American exceptionalism, hypernationalism. And what they're seeing going on in American streets concerns them. One of the biggest organizations that this concerns is the brand new American Legion. And by the end of 1919, it'll have 1 million members. Think about that. That's 1 in 4 doughboys are a member of the American Legion. The organization itself is extremely conservative. They are anti-radical. They believe that the citizenship obligation of the veteran is to make sure that 100% Americanism reigns in the Republic. And if you got to bend the Constitution to save it, so be it. Now, what this means is legionnaires are surveilling their neighbors in search of radicals, and at times are participating with raids by the Bureau of Investigation and other government entities of known or suspected radicals. Now, what you start to see in 1919, though, is the veterans are not homogeneous. You have the American Legion as probably one of the most powerful organizations, but other doughboys disagree with their policies or where the Republic's going. Most tragically, this will occur, you'll see this occur in Centralia, Washington, on the first Armistice Day celebration in November 1919. The Legionnaires in Centralia have long distrusted the industrial workers of the world, and they were going to use the parade that day to raid the IWW house. Well, in the process, as they're getting close to the IWW house, shots ring out from inside, killing 4 Legionnaires. The Legionnaires get a little upset, as you might believe, attack everybody who's in the building, and take who they believe the ringleader and the murderer was, Wesley Everett, take him to a local railroad bridge and lynch him from it. Wesley Everett, though, was himself a veteran of World War I. Now, this war is also going to try to change some of the social and racial dynamics. Due to the war itself, there's a massive migration of African Americans for the first time leaving the South, going to the North. And this is going to cause some racial tensions. So in 1919, not only do you have labor disputes, but you have a series of race riots that cut across. Now, Amanda Nagel is going to discuss the issue of African American service in World War I tomorrow, so I'm not going to get too deeply into that, except to say that these 380,000 African American veterans believe that their service entitles them to full citizenship within the United States. But for the most part, they're going to meet with a buzzsaw of opposition. And what you start to see is white veterans fighting African American veterans for what they believe America should look like. For example, in the race riot in Washington, D.C., at least 12 African American veterans are killed during the riot. And between December 1918 and July 1920, at least 18 African American veterans are lynched in the South, some of them for refusing to take off their uniforms when the local whites demand it. So all of this stuff is questioning what it means to be a veteran, what it means to be a citizen. But the veteran's number one concern, of course, is the economy. Like Bill Clinton said, it's the economy, stupid. The economy is in doldrums. It's slow to recover over the first 3-4 years of the armistice. And the doughboys, just like the Civil War generation before them, believed that their sacrifice, and at what was at this time the largest war in American history, demanded some recompense. Now, their argument was they're not looking for a handout. Their whole justification for a bonus was, the government took me out of the prime years of my life against my will, sent me overseas where I could be killed or injured. That demands something on my part. Help us out in the midst of this economic disaster. Now, citizens, congressmen, supporters are starting to push for the immediate payment of a large bonus. They're going to run into a buzzsaw of opposition from both the Harding administration, the Coolidge administration, the American Chamber of Commerce, the Secretary of the Treasury, that simply says, at this point in time, the budget cannot afford it. The American Legion and the Veterans of Foreign War are in the lead, just like the former GAR, in pushing forward compensation. The American Legion, though, cannot escape its conservative roots and agrees to a compromise that they'll push through Congress. The compromise is this, the World War Adjusted Compensation Act. Now, this is essentially a life insurance type policy in the form of a Treasury certificate that would not mature until 1945. And it was based on the idea of compensation that for every day of service that the doughboy spent in the United States, they'd get a dollar. And for every day they were overseas, they'd get $1.25 to a maximum payout of $625. To tell you how much support the veterans have, when Coolidge objects to even these limited measures, the Congress and the Senate easily override that veto. Now, veterans' issue after this sort of goes on the back burner. The American economy is kicking, the roaring 20s are roaring, the doughboys are mostly employed and making money. As we all know, though, that comes crashing down in October of 1929. And increasing studies are showing in 1929 to 1932 that it seems like the veterans are being disproportionately disadvantaged by this economic downturn. In fact, the Veteran Administration's own study in 1931 says that at least 25% of the World War's veterans are out of work. And in that key demographic, age 30 to 46, those that were most likely to have served and fought in the war, that their unemployment rate was at least 50% higher than the non-veteran. Faced with this veteran suffering, those veterans begin again a pressure campaign as they see their rights as citizens to push for an immediate payment of that bonus that had been promised by the Congress in 1923. Their paladin throughout this whole period will be the Texas Congressman Wright Patman. Patman himself was a combat veteran from World War I. What he proposes is exactly what the doughboys want. The doughboys need money, pay them the money, it's the obligation. The rest of the members of both sides of the party know well, damn well, that Hoover is going to veto this legislation if it comes before his desk. So as a half measure, what they allow veterans to do is take out a loan against the value of these bonuses. Now this is going to be a poison pill. For the interest accrued on the loan will ultimately eat up all of the remaining principal by 1945. The veterans, though, hope that some of their support is going to increase. Now, we don't have time to talk about the bonus march. The BOTUS marchers, 20,000 veterans, are descending upon Washington to lobby the Congress or the administration to change its mind. Give us the bonus now. And when it becomes evident that this is going to fail, all but 7,000 of them leave. The other 7,000 have nowhere else to go. And as we know, there's a fear in the government that this group of veterans is infested with communists bent on overturning the government. And so Hoover uses the army to forcibly remove them from D.C. This is going to lead to a firestorm in the United States. More support for the veterans, and will all but nail down Franklin Roosevelt's victory in the election of 1932. Now, in that election, the veterans are hoping that they're also going to get a new deal, that you're going to get a more sympathetic hearing from Franklin Roosevelt, who claims to be supporting the common man. But we forget that at the beginning, Franklin Roosevelt is a fiscal conservative. He sees that the economy is an absolute free fall, that the banking system's about to collapse, and with it, the rest of the economy. So he takes a radical measure. In March of 1933, he passes the Economy Act. What that basically does is slashes government expenditures to free up some cash to deal with these other economic problems. Roosevelt's belief is that the veterans have to pay their way just like everybody else in these cuts. What it meant for the veterans themselves was, on average, a 50% cut in whatever pension they were already receiving. Keep in mind, these are disabled veterans. And a reduction of over 500,000 veterans from the pension rolls altogether. Roosevelt understands that this is going to be wildly unpopular with the veterans, and so he's looking for a sympathetic ear. He attends the American Legion Convention in 1933 because he understands that the Legion is much more conservative than the VFW, and this is the justification he gives to explain his acts. He said, sure, the government has an obligation to disabled vets, even though we're cutting 50% of their benefits, but any other veteran who was not disabled is owed nothing more from their government than any non-veteran. Now, you can imagine, if you're a veteran, this goes over like a lead balloon. And you start to see clashes within these veterans' organizations. While the American Legion continues to have a more conservative, conciliatory stance, the VFW, under James Van Zandt, is much more militant. In response to FDR's speech at the American Legion Convention, Van Zandt holds the VFW's annual convention. The two invited guest speakers are Smedley Butler and the populist firebrand Huey P. Long from Louisiana, both of who were vehement in their support for veterans' rights. Now, in the midst of this, Patman has not given up hope of getting an immediate payment of the bonus. He makes common cause with Van Zandt. In fact, both men are willing to shake hands with the devil to get the veterans the benefits that they believe they need, to include, in times, turning to the anti-Semitic Catholic chaplain Charles Coughlin, and the power of radio to keep building up popular American support. Patman will try again to get an immediate bonus payment in 1934. Roosevelt vetoes it again, based on the same idea that he had in 1933. Patman is unbowed. Again, he will try to pass a bonus bill in 1935. This time, Roosevelt believes that it is necessary for him to leave the White House and actually speak on the floor of the Congress to explain why he's going to veto that bill too. If you'll notice the words he's using, they're basically the same thing that he had rolled out in the American Legion Convention 2 years before. Now, Roosevelt was slowly but surely recognizing that the veterans' issue was becoming a political liability, and more support was accruing to their cause. Now, he had hoped to somehow siphon away some of that radicalism and discontent by giving veterans preferential treatment in some of the New Deal's public works program. Even that, ironically, blew up in his face. On Labor Day 1935, the Florida Keys is hit by one of the most powerful hurricanes in American history. 18-foot storm surge covers most of the islands that link the Upper Keys. Oh, on their islands, there are 400 dead, including 257 veterans. Now, those 257 veterans had been sent by the Federal Emergency Relief Administration to build the roads and bridges that would link mainland Florida all the way to the Florida Keys. Now, into this we step Ernest Hemingway. Hemingway had actually been drinking beer with some of these veterans down at Sloppy Joe's in Key West. And within a day of the hurricane passing, he visits the site. And what he sees there and the stories he's hearing from the veterans infuriates him to the fact that he immediately pens an article, "Who Murdered the Vets?" And in Hemingway's mind, it's damn clear who murdered the vets: Franklin Delano Roosevelt. He would argue that not only did the government send these veterans to live in horrible conditions in the midst of hurricane season, but they did so in a deliberate political act to make sure that the veterans were far away from Washington as possible so there'd be no repeat to the bonus march. This, again, is used by Van Zandt and the veterans themselves to push for their political agenda. Patman will have one more try. This time it's lucky, though. The fourth Patman bonus bill will pass easily by both houses of the Congress. True to form, the minute that bill hits Franklin Roosevelt's desk, he vetoes it. But what had changed now was the attitudes of the American people and the activism of the veterans themselves. This time, the Senate musters enough votes to easily overturn FDR's veto. What goes into effect is the Adjusted Compensation Payment Act. It now gets rid of those life insurance certificates and issues the veterans hard treasury bonds. And the veterans can immediately cash that in, or if they choose, they could leave it with the government accruing 5% interest until 1945. And for those interest payments done on the bonus payout loans in 1931, the government will erase them too. Now, the other speakers who are going to follow me are also going to talk about citizen veterans who marched on their capitals. The United States is a little different here. Now, part of it is the context is different. The United States ends the war while their economic problems relatively intact, while Italy and Germany are facing monumental social, political, economic realities. The other reason why the veterans ultimately get what they want in the United States is they believed in the system. And the system worked for them. It was slow, it was painful, it was ponderous, but at the end of the day, American democracy worked. Thank you very much.
Am I on? I'm going to differ from the last two speakers. Imagine the challenge of following somebody like Gary Armstrong and then Sean Faulkner. I'm going to probably hold fast to the podium. My ancient knees will not tolerate the peripatetic approach that the previous two speakers had. And I have to open by saying I find this particular topic a daunting one in a 20-minute format. And what I'll offer you is sort of impressionistic and evocative, but it's a long way from being comprehensive. Let me give this thing a test drive. There it is. Okay. Let me start by going back to the German Reichstag building, finished in 1894, and it was intended as a symbol of the unity of the new German Empire. It had been financed by reparations from the Franco-Prussian War, and in a design to inspire the nationalist spirit that this building was meant to convey, the architect, a guy named Paul Wallet, decided that over the entryway should be the words "Dem Deutschen Volke," to the German people. But that last piece of architectural planning was vetoed, was blocked, and the report came back. It was the Kaiser who objected to the democratic sentiments in that. And by leaving that inscription absent from the Reichstag, it created a firestorm of controversy and dissent that lasted over 20 years into World War I. And evident of the ongoing controversy is this cartoon from a German comic magazine, Kladderach, appears in September 1915. And there you see a German veteran using his bayonet to put the inscription above the entryway. And you can read the doggerel that goes along with it. The message is clear. When the German soldier returns from the front lines of World War I, he's going to expect full citizenship within the German Reich. He's going to expect recognition for the sacrifices that he's made in the name of the German nation. Now, the momentum of the controversy carried on into the next year, where the imperial cabinet, the Kaiser's advisors, realized that the patriotism was waning and the Kaiser's popularity was waning with it, and it might be time to go ahead and put the inscription over the Reichstag. And thus, they commissioned a brass foundry in Berlin owned by the S.A. Loewy Company, a long-established Jewish family in the Berlin community, to go ahead and put the bronze letters above the Reichstag. And the task is accomplished by December of 1916, just before Christmas. But, and this is what it looks like today. Now these words, "this changed the Reichstag," is one of the smallest changes that German soldiers are going to experience when they return to the fatherland at the end of World War I. When they left, they had hoped, they were promised victory, and instead they returned to a Germany that was defeated, starving, and threadbare. Whereas they'd left an imperial monarchy when they marched off to the front line, they returned to an improvised socialist republic, one that had been proclaimed in a spontaneous proclamation from the balcony of the Reichstag. This cartoon captures the bewilderment of the German soldier returning home. There, what you see here is the leaders of the various leftist parties in the German parliaments trying to seduce Germania, the homeland. And he's asking, okay, what kind of fatherland am I returning to? He had reason to be perplexed. Now, there was a brief honeymoon period. Demobilization of the 8 million men under arms in November of 1918 happened fairly rapidly, if a little bit chaotically, and this allowed most soldiers to be home by Christmas. And as they marched through the cities of Germany, they were greeted by cheering crowds, and at the same time, the chancellor of the new Socialist Republic, Friedrich Ebert, told them that the new republic would allow increased opportunities for peace and prosperity. There's reason for hope. And for the older men who had gone off to war, there's the chance to be home, rejoin family, perhaps take up the old occupation. But for the younger men, there's a little more uncertainty about what the future held. Now, nevertheless, all veterans felt this way, that this needed to be a republic that recognized their sacrifice. 2 million Germans had died in World War I, and millions more mourned them. And the veterans, together with these families, ensured that monuments appeared across Germany. To this day, if you go through the German countryside, every single tiny German village has a war monument created immediately after World War I, an attempt to memorialize what had happened during the war. But this was perhaps a tougher problem. 1.4 million Germans had been disabled by the war. Many more had been orphaned or widowed by the war, and they expected an obligation from the new republic. And they joined organizations like this, the Reich League of Disabled War Veterans, Ex-Servicemen, and War Dependents, to create a social network to support them. And this is going to create an enormous burden for the new Weimar Republic, which is already saddled with the heavy, heavy load of reparations from the Versailles Treaty. But what are the other veterans? During the war, German frontline soldiers gave themselves the title Frontschweine, the front hogs, a sort of a self-deprecating but proud term of what they were experiencing. And psychologists tell us that it's easier for us to cast out bad memories than good ones. And many of them harken back to what they call the Frontgemeinschaft, the community of the front, the camaraderie they'd felt in the trenches. And this is going to inspire a massive joining of veterans groups after the war. Pictured here is one called the Kufreuserbund, which was established before the war, and it's sort of an apolitical umbrella group designed to welcome veterans. And this picture suggests a characteristic of this veterans' culture, a fascination with uniforms, a desire to march, and some historians would say a caricature of masculine display, if you will. The most famous of the veterans group is this one, the Stahlhelm, the steel helmet, the League of Frontline Soldiers, founded immediately after the war by Franz Selter, who'd lost an arm in the war. By 1930, it had 500,000 members. Now, its values were patriotic, nationalist, and monarchist. And these values made it hostile to the Republic. It would not, for example, allow Jewish members in the group. And by 1933, the leaders of the Stahlhelm are going to subordinate the Stahlhelm to the Nazi Party, which will turn around quickly and dissolve it because it's not affiliated with the Nazi Party. So, closed out by the main veteran group, Jewish veterans are going to band together to create this group here, the Reich League of Jewish Frontline Soldiers. Okay, about 36,000 members. You can see from this flyer what their agenda is. To try to nip the anti-Semitism in the Weimar Republic by highlighting the contribution of Jews to the war. The only group that was overtly and consistently pro-Republic is this one, the Reichsbanner Schwarz-Rot-Gold, or Black-Red-Gold, the colors of the Weimar flag. By 1925, it numbered 3 million members. There we go. And in contrast to conservative groups, which tended to glorify the war experience, they emphasized the war's horrors, the need for peace and democracy. And this group in particular is the only real bulwark to the Republic among the veterans groups. Now, in contrast to the veterans group that I've discussed so far, some veterans looked at the Weimar Republic with grievance and betrayal. On the left, in particular, you have a group like this. Veterans on the left tended to believe they had been betrayed by the Weimar Republic, first by not completing the revolution, and then secondly, by using the Freikorps to crush worker uprisings in the immediate post-war period. This group here will have 85,000 members and be led. It is the paramilitary arm of the Communist Party, led by Ernst Thälmann, who had served as a veteran in the war and then deserted in the very last week of the war. Again, they will be banned after what's called Bloody May in 1929, be followed by a group called the Anti-Fascist Action Front, which are the ideological forerunner of today's Antifa. Okay. And then there are these guys, the more famous Sturmabteilung. They believed the Republic had betrayed the veterans, first by the stab in the back theory that the anti-war sentiment had undermined the war effort, and then by submitting the Germany to the terms of the Versailles Treaty. By the early 1930s, they will have some 3 million members. Now, they are led by Ernst Röhm at their highest point, who commands a machine gun company during the war. Of course, they will be murdered in the Night of the Long Knives. It's important to note, when they reach the 3 million mark in the early 30s, the rank and file, the guys you see in the picture, are not veterans. They are the children of veterans. They're sort of the lost children that grew up during the Great War. The leaders will be veterans, though, and that's the same for the Communist Frontline Group. And together, these two generations are going to be the action and street fighting arm of the Nazi Party as they ascend to power. Now, it's important to note that all these veterans we're talking about, most wanted to return to peace and stability, but enough of them opted to do something else, and that's why I'd say The 400,000, so according to some counts, who joined the Freikorps will help make the Weimar Republic a republic of violence. And the Weimar Republic is going to be stricken by violent episodes all through its history, but especially in the early 20s and then again in the early 30s. And veterans are involved in almost every incident. Now, you've heard of the beer hall putsch with Hitler, but there's the Buchrucker putsch, there's the Kopp putsch, there's the grim campaign of the Freikorps going through the German cities in 1919. There's fighting in Poland, fighting in the Baltics, and there's a wave of right-wing political assassinations done by hit squads from these kind of grim-sounding units like the Organisation Consul, the Viking League, the Sturmabteilung Rosbach, and the Black Reichswehr. And all these, of course, are going to undermine the legitimacy of the Weimar Republic. This, of course, what's pictured here is the most famous in German history march on the capital, the Kopp putsch of March 1920. Exactly two months earlier, there's another march on the capital, something that's called the Reichstag bloodbath. In this instance, 100,000 to 150,000 angry workers assemble outside the Reichstag to protest legislations that can limit union activity. Now, the Reichstag is secured by what's called the Sicherheitspolizei, the SIPO, who are recruited exclusively from frontline veterans. There's an incident on the south entrance where some politicians are manhandled, there's a shot rings out, and the SIPO, the security police, opens fire with machine guns and hand grenades. And you see the casualty figures here. Let's see if I can get this thing to work, okay? Again, veterans and violence. That's a salient feature of the Weimar Republic. And while the Weimar Republic has a brief honeymoon period in the late 20s, when it comes to a crisis in 1930, the veterans will not be what Gary Armstrong called the civic nationalists that will rally to it in its time of crisis. I started with a cartoon. I'm going to end with one I've used here before. And another German humor magazine, Simplicissimus, in the late 20s comes up with this, and you see all the various parts of German society, clerics, businessmen, soldiers, workers, radicals, bankers, artists, and brown shirts, all of them with a heavy representation of veterans. But do they really support the public? Or is it, as sometimes often said, a republic without Republicans? You know, a republic that needed citizens that would rally to it. We know the answer. And I'll return finally to the Reichstag. I mean, we know it's burning in February of 1933 is going to give Hitler the pretext for enacting his most draconian measures to solidify his regime. And it's interesting that the Jewish family that put these words above the entryway, the Levy family, is going to be divided by that event. About half of them are going to flee to the United States. The other half remain in Berlin and will go to the death camps as a result. So I'll conclude by saying this, or make this concluding comment, that had the, historians are typically discouraged from considering hypothetical scenarios, but one can only wonder if the veterans had rallied to the Weimar Republic as voters, as fathers, as community leaders, as military officers, as citizens, we can imagine there might have been a different outcome. And with that, I'll conclude. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, in just a few seconds, we will be hearing from Dr. Vanda Wilcox, who is coming to us live from Milan, Italy. So in just about 30 seconds, you will see her up on the screen. From Dr. Vanda Wilcox, who is coming to us live from Milan, Italy. So in just about 30 seconds, you will see her up on the screen.
Should I just go straight into screen share?
Hello, Dr. Wilcox. Yes, please feel free. We can hear you loud and clear from Kansas City.
Okay, great. Hello. Is that working?
Yep, we've got it loud, nice and bright.
Okay, great. Are we ready to go? I can't see anything, so it's a bit confusing. Okay. Thank you so much for inviting me, and I only wish I could be there with you in Kansas City. I'm going to talk about servicemen as citizens and subjects in First World War Italy, and focus more on both wartime and that immediate post-war period. On the 9th of June 1916, more than a year after Italy had entered the war, a homeless man in central Italy was arrested by military police as a draft evader. When the men of his year group had been called up, he had failed to report to his local military district. When questioned, he said he hadn't realised that during war, citizens were obliged to present themselves for service. He was not alone in failing to realise his duties as a citizen. A number of Italians were wrongly advised, including by their own local authorities, that they didn't need to serve, that there was no obligation to report. Perhaps the most extreme case is a guy from a remote region of Emilia who was arrested in January 1918, so nearly 3 years into the war. He claimed, "I live up in the high mountains. I didn't know that we had to go too." So clearly some men like this character were pushing their luck, but the fact remains that not all Italians understood that as citizens, they were obliged to perform military service in wartime. Unlike the American case that we heard about very brilliantly in the first talk, the link between citizenship and military service was not so clearly and deeply embedded in the Italian mentality. In fact, Italian citizens were subject to the draft, even in peacetime. Military service was mandatory for all men once they reached their majority. So to fail to realise this was a sign that the rights and responsibilities of citizenship were not always fully internalised by Italians in the late 19th and early 20th century. And the Italian state hadn't done a huge amount to deal with this problem. It's not until the war breaks out that we start to see a real concerted effort to teach Italian citizens what the duties and obligations of citizenship might be. And this is just the front cover of a booklet which outlines what both men and women should be doing in wartime. And it covers an enormous range of topics from personal conduct, self-discipline, self-control, through to the obligation of reporting suspicious characters in your neighbourhood and of keeping yourself healthy and eating good food. So Italian citizens didn't necessarily recognise military service as a fundamental part of their duties. Many of them had rejected military service even in peacetime. About 10% of Italian men usually evaded the draft, even before the First World War. And when the first class of men is called up once the war has begun, there is actually a higher rate of draft evasion in wartime than there had been in peacetime. Wartime increased the rates of draft evasion, basically due to the very high personal costs of service, but also the lack of obvious benefits for nation or individual. One example is a young anarchist from Calabria, a guy called Bruno Mezzefari. He says, "Why did I come? Why did I answer present to the call made by and in the name of men and ideals which have nothing to do with me? I don't know the king or the fatherland. They call me up, they want me, they force me to sacrifice myself for them. By what right? What have they ever given to me? I detest the state. It overwhelms me. It oppresses me. The fatherland is nothing but a trick, a mess, a lie." So this is perhaps an extreme example, but like many of his fellow Italians, Bruno Mezzefari did not feel himself genuinely bound by mutual and reciprocal obligations of citizenship, including the obligation of military service. There were good reasons for this. In 1915, only about 65% of Italians were literate. thus able to read notices and information from the state, such as their call-up papers, for instance. And in remote rural areas in some parts of the South and islands, the literacy rate would be much lower. Some regions show only around one third of all adults able to read and write competently at the start of the First World War. And it's hard to imagine how to convey a modern conception of citizenship based on reciprocal rights and duties without literacy. Equally important is the fact that a core element in citizenship, namely full political rights, was a very new idea. In fact, before the First World War, the Italian state had primarily seen the masses more as subjects than as citizens, as subjects who simply owed loyalty and obedience to the king and his ministers. The idea of a nation in arms, a mass citizen army, drew on the rhetoric of Italian unification, which had been achieved in the mid-19th century. But in reality, the Italian army was a sort of pocket entity, hived off from mainstream Italian political culture and loyal directly to the king. It did not really represent a kind of nation in arms, a mass citizen army. So what did it mean to be an Italian citizen? Italy in this period has been described as a democracy in the making. Only in 1912 had a law been passed giving the vote to all male citizens over the age of 21 who had completed their elementary education. So that still excluded some on the basis of literacy, essentially, and only male citizens over the age of 30, whatever their literacy. So that's 1912. The first new election under this law had only been held in 1913. So insofar as it's a democracy at all, it's a brand new one. So through the first 50 years of unified Italy, the obligation of military service for all men had not had any corollary in terms of political rights. And I think that's important because neither side of the contract between the individual citizen and the state had been operating as we might expect it to. Immediately after the war, the voting law is amended again, just shortly in time for the 1919 elections. The requirement was removed for literacy or for the education completing requirement, so that any men over the age of 21 could now vote. And most importantly, men between the ages of 18 and 21 could now vote if they'd served in the armed forces during the war. So for the first time, the link between military service and the full rights of citizenship is made explicit. During the war itself, many of the men who served would never have been previously eligible to vote because they hadn't completed elementary school or because of their age, but veterans would be guaranteed the vote thereafter. It's also worth noting that unlike some other countries, Italy does not grant voting rights to women immediately after the war. Italian women couldn't vote in national elections until 1946. And although a new law was passed in 1919, which granted women greater legal status, very much in line with parallel movements that granted women greater status on the basis of their wartime activities in other countries, this explicitly excluded women from the exercise of any political or military rights. So the law about women's legal status and the law that reformed suffrage in general reinforced the link between political rights and military service, which had previously not existed. Political rights had not been the only side of Italian citizenship, which was perhaps rather weak before 1912. The exercise of civil rights was often much less equal than the constitution implied. It was a country in which kind of quasi-feudal patron-client relations were still very powerful. The only real positive intervention of the state into many ordinary Italians' lives before the First World War was the provision of universal state primary education. But that too was patchy and often inadequate. Citizenship, in other words, was at best abstract and at worst actually a set of unwelcome impositions, and many Italians felt little real connection to the state. Now, why does this matter? Why have I gone into detail about what citizenship meant to Italians at this point? Well, it matters because in wartime, an effective conscript army needs to have some sense of innate connection between the citizens and the state. In order to have the kind of cohesion and military effectiveness that we would look for in a functioning armed forces. Now, the legal changes which took place immediately before and after the war should, therefore, in theory, have made veterans feel more truly citizens than ever before. This should have been the critical moment of transition from feeling like subjects into feeling like citizens. So, did this actually work? Did the experience of the First World War increase Italians' sense of themselves as citizens, and particularly servicemen's sense of themselves as citizens? Did they consider themselves to be part of a network of reciprocal rights and duties to the, and with the state? The problem here is, if to be a citizen is to be engaged in this social contract between the democratic state and yourself, what happens when the state falls down on its side of the bargain? And during the war, the state could be seen as failing to uphold its end of the bargain in several core ways. Firstly, soldiers had a very different legal status than civilians. Whereas the Italian state had abolished the death penalty for civilians in 1889, the military continued to use the death penalty, and very regularly. In fact, the Italian army executed more of its own men than any other Western European army in the First World War. So the protection that the Italian state offered to civilians from the death penalty ceases as soon as you're called to arms. Other penalties, such as life imprisonment, hard labor, were also implied in exceptionally harsh ways. Key legal protections, civil rights such as the right to a fair trial, the right to appeal, are systematically denied to Italian servicemen throughout the war. If you know anything about the Italian army, you may know that the Italians practice both summary execution and even a few cases of decimation during the war. So in other words, the state fails to guarantee basic civil liberties to its citizens as soon as they are in the armed forces. The state fails to protect its citizens who come under military authority. It's very hard, therefore, for veterans or for servicemen to see themselves as citizens in arms when the essential guarantees of citizenship are not being granted to them. The second way in which I think we can see the state very clearly failing to uphold its end of the bargain is that it abandons many of its important constitutional safeguards. Even before joining the war, in March 1915, the Parliament voted to suspend its normal powers of scrutiny and control so that the government could essentially pass decrees without any process of legislative scrutiny. So the legislative hands over all power to the executive. The executive then, in turn, handed over almost all authority to supreme command, the military command. There's almost no power of civilian scrutiny and control exercised, certainly for the first 3 years of the first 2.5 years of the war to the end of 1917. So what this means is that regular parliamentary government and civilian scrutiny of military leadership, and together with those, the protection of basic civil liberties, are all abandoned during the war. If citizenship is supposed to be a reciprocal relationship between individuals and states, once again, it's hard to see how the state is keeping its end up. It's worth noting at this point that citizenship, or sense of citizenship, is not the same as a sense of national identity. People have often noted that Italians didn't necessarily feel very Italian in the period of the First World War. A sense of national identity certainly increased during the period of 1915 to 1918. Historians have debated how that worked and how far it went, but many Italians certainly did feel much more connected to Italy and to some of the symbols of Italianness by the end of the war. They visited parts of the country they'd never seen before. Some of them have started to learn standard Italian rather than Italian dialect. They've mingled with people from other parts of the country. They've been subject to a kind of intense bombardment of nationalist propaganda. So an increase in national sentiment has definitely happened. But just because you feel that you belong to a nation does not necessarily mean a sense of allegiance to the state or to the existing government and structures. The one area where we can see the state really successfully operating in wartime is by increasing welfare provision, really for the first time. Pensions to those who've been killed or disabled in action, support for families, separation allowances, the provision of healthcare, These are really important radical new changes, new kinds of intervention from the state, which do foreshadow later developments under fascism. But they're not part of this language of rights and duties. They're not framed within the language of civil liberties and the structure of citizenship in the way that they might have been. So by 1919, Italy has a new growing nationalist movement, but one which is divorced from the framework of constitutional government, checks and balances, mutual obligations, and indeed the whole framework of democracy. So in the chaotic post-war years of 1919 to 22, many veterans get caught up in movements which explicitly place them outside the normal framework of citizenship, namely paramilitary movements, and ultimately, just as in Germany, support for movements which embrace the revolutionary overthrow of the government. So I now want to turn to the role of these veterans in that period, 1919 to 22. First up, demobilization as a process was extremely slow in Italy. Partly this is because of ongoing commitments outside of Italy. Italian troops are sent to take part of the occupation of Constantinople. Italians are occupying parts of southern Turkey. They're also engaged actively in fighting in Albania until 1920. There are Italians sent to the Far East, to Upper Silesia, to the Baltic. A very large number of soldiers are also still involved in garrisoning the colonies. So there's a lot of Italians in Libya, in North Africa, and also in the East African colonies. This means that Italians who were overseas didn't begin to return to Italy until June or July 1919. And when we get to the summer of 1920, there's still nearly a quarter of a million men posted overseas. And of course, that's only the ones who are outside of Italian territory. There's plenty of Italian soldiers still in service within the national territory or in the newly occupied areas that Italy has conquered at the end of the war. So many conscripts aren't actually demobilized until the end of 1920, December 1920. And that's a really long time after the war has ended to still be in service as a conscript. And not unnaturally, this creates quite a lot of resentment. One reason for this, as well as these various ongoing occupations and kind of military adventures that the government has signed up to, one reason is owing to the very high rates of unemployment at home. So like many other countries, Italy has a huge economic crisis at the end of the war. Wartime industry is stopped, rates of unemployment rise, and the government really doesn't want to make this situation worse by rapidly demobilizing. But the slowness with which demobilization happens is definitely seen as another sign of the state not really upholding its share of the bargain. At the same time, as the socialist movement grows stronger and stronger, there's a growing number of strikes and protests happening through 1919-1920. This is a period which is often known as the Biennio Rosso, the Red 2 Years. And this encourages the government to want to keep men in the army to suppress any radical left-wing disorder. So we end up with a vicious circle. The more there is discontent in the country and the more protests there are, the more the government wants to keep the army large. The larger the army is, the more men who are prevented from being released, the more general discontent there is with that among the men themselves and their families. One big problem, of course, is the debate as to how veterans are to be financially supported in this time of mass unemployment. In the final 2 years of the war, to deal with wartime disaffection, a number of promises have been made about better financial treatment for soldiers and veterans. And this is going to take a lot of funding and organization. The government doesn't operate very effectively in this area, and we see the springing up of multiple new veterans associations. As in other countries, these veterans associations quickly become major political forces in their own right. They're not all right-wing. There is perhaps an assumption that veterans' bodies automatically lean to the right, and they do, many of them, end up supporting the extreme nationalists and joining the fascist movement. But there's also far-left proletariat veterans' leagues operating in 1919-1920. The social and political conflict that Italy as a whole has is actually mirrored amongst the veterans' community too. But to focus on the physical and administrative side of demobilization, which is a slow and messy process, is really only one half of the story. Even more important is psychological and cultural demobilization. So there's two key issues here. The first is that the army as a whole does not want to return to its previous marginalized situation in Italian politics. After the war, the army becomes unprecedentedly politicized. Beforehand, it had generally stayed out of political affairs. It was loyal only to the king. Army officers were somewhat marginalized in mainstream political life. But during the war, they've enjoyed unprecedented social and political power, and they don't really want to go back to the old way of doing things. They regard the return of peace with unease, if not open hostility. And the weakness and disorganization of civilian government has raised a lot of questions about the entire constitutional structure. Young officers, junior officers in particular, tend to believe by 1919 that they deserve a greater say in the peacetime life of the new Italy they fought so hard to create. We could also here speak of what I'm going to call the veterans to fascists pipeline. Just like these professional officers, for many veterans, there is a clear sense that they're unwilling to psychologically demobilize, to accept that the war is over. As public order degenerates in Italy and Italian politics becomes more and more violent, more and more chaotic, many veterans start to join paramilitary organizations, the Italian action squads or black shirts, who become the shock troops of the new fascist movement. This is a remobilization of veterans who feel that the war has not yet been complete. The greater Italy they promised has not yet been achieved. The victory that Italy has won on the battlefield has not translated into a better society. And instead of fighting the Austrians, these men remobilize psychologically to face a new enemy, the internal enemy of left-wingers and increasingly the internal enemy of democracy itself. Critically, many veterans believe they've earned the right, perhaps even the duty, to reshape Italy now that the war has ended. Military service is no longer a duty among a reciprocal network of mutual obligations, but it's an action which brings with it entitlements, which the state has consistently failed to respond to. So what we see is we see veterans taking matters into their own hands. Citizenship in the legal constitutional sense has been fatally undermined, really by the war, the state's own errors and failings in wartime. But a kind of active citizenship in the sense of feeling a deep personal stake in the fate of society, a symbolic participatory citizenship, has been significantly increased among many veterans. They perceive themselves as having rights and duties, not towards the liberal constitution, not towards democracy, but towards Italy, or a concept of Italy, which is increasingly going to be embodied and capitalized on by Mussolini and his action squads. So the men who join the action squads, the men who campaign in the National Combatants Association, who support fascism, and who ultimately march on Rome in October 1922, fitted their actions into a rewritten model of citizenship, not one structured within the foundation of democracy, but one born, as Mussolini himself was very keen to repeat, in the trenches. Italian soldiers from 15 to 18 had been told they owed a duty of military service as citizens, but without receiving the rights that that status usually conferred. After the war, Italian servicemen thus come to perpetuate a different model of citizenship, which is ironically closer to subjecthood, and which moves towards a new Italy, which actually strips away many of the civil and legal rights which the liberal state they destroyed had previously guaranteed them. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen,
fantastic.
If you have...
Fantastic. Thank you so very much. We are going to be taking your questions via the text line, which is right here, if you want the fastest way to get your questions to these three, and through the postcards that you will see our museum educators walking on either side of the auditorium to do. And if you are joining us on Zoom, again, thank you guys so much. We're so pleased to have you here. I can see your questions right now on Q&A. Vanda, if you're able to turn your camera on for us, that would be great. And the first question is...
It says that it's been disabled by the host, so I can't do that. I tried.
You know what, y'all? I said 10 years, and it was about time for something to snarl on us here. Thank you very much.
Oh, there we go.
Fantastic. All right. So to all three of you, Dr. Armstrong talked about the importance of regionalism earlier this morning. Did the soldiers, veterans of each nation you spoke on have views on their attachment to their state's regions versus their nation states? Scott, would you feel comfortable starting?
Yeah, I would. During the war, as the war dragged on, war weariness sort of overcame Germany, you'll start to see fractures in what had been a federal empire, so that Prussians and Bavarians would get into fistfight on troop trains, and the Bavarians would say, hey, you know, this is not our war. You Prussians dragged us into this. Among the Allies, it was famous that you were across from a Saxon unit, for example, that things were going to be quiet because they were not nearly as warlike as their Prussian countrymen. After the war, veterans are going to be involved in the violence that takes place. For example, when as the war ends, Bavaria is going to declare itself an independent Soviet republic, and Freikorps from all over Germany are going to come down and crush that Soviet republic in early 1919. Similarly, veterans are going to be involved in crushing a Rhenish separatist, a Rhineland separatist movement that the French are fostering, and veterans. Are perhaps more invested in the idea of a unified Germany, but that is going to show regional differences over time. Veterans are also going to be involved in fighting separatist movements on the Polish border, for example. Now, how well veterans see citizenship according to what region? Prussia is the dominant part of the German Empire. And they're going to have a probably more solidified view of being part of a unified Germany. But the war did have a unifying effect overall in what was a pretty strong regionalism before the war.
Well, the United States was already broken into regions before the war broke out. The South, the Northeast, the Middle States on the East Coast, of course, the Midwest, the Far West, the Southwest, and of course, as Dr. Anderson pointed out, also Texas by themselves. And the way that the United States mobilizes to some extent reinforces this. National Guard units are mobilized first for the Mexican border crisis and then for the war itself. And so they're bringing that regionalism in. And even the draft, which is supposed to cut across the United States, tends to be regionally based. So to some extent, it is reinforcing that regionalism. In fact, when the veterans come back, they're publishing their own unit histories that oftentimes play up the regionalism, but the states themselves are publishing their history of their roles in the war. That being said, again, I stand by this issue that the veterans came back from France with a renewed sense of American exceptionalism. So on one hand, you have sectionalism working hand in hand with this new idea of an American identity.
For the Italians, regionalism is really important. It's been a very strong source of identity for a really long time. And many Italians identify more with their region or even with a hometown or a kind of quite small micro area rather than with Italy. This is something that definitely shifts a bit during the war, particularly among soldiers, in that they have this unifying national experience in a way. And if anything, the divisions in Italian society post-war might be more along class lines or more along rural versus urban lines rather than along straightforward regional lines. But regional identity doesn't go away, and the very different experiences of, for example, regions that are close to the front lines versus regions that are a long way away does color how people think about the whole experience and the extent to which they, the ways in which they respond to the rise of fascism afterwards too.
What can you all say about the different diasporas that might have occurred after World War I and the view of citizenship that that provided? And there's a variety of diasporas that you can be speaking to on that.
Well, the most important in American history was actually occurring in the war years, when for the first time, large numbers of African Americans, up to 800,000, if not a million, depending on the stats, leave the South for the first time and head to the Midwest and the East in search of these war-related jobs. That diaspora will create, for example, the Harlem Renaissance in many ways, but it'll also come with increased tensions. The African-American population of Philadelphia, for example, increases by 500% from 1914 to 1919, and that causes some tensions. In fact, as soon as the war breaks out, there's a massive and ugly race riot. It's one of the most violent in American history when these newly arrived African-Americans from the South settle in East St. Louis, Illinois. And that'll end up with nearly or over 100 casualties. So that diaspora happens, but it also causes a deep increase of social tension.
There's not anything necessarily analogous for the German case, except immediately after the war, Germany had lost about 13% of its territory due to the Versailles Treaty, and you have Germans having to leave parts of what have become Denmark, parts of what has become Belgium, parts of what has become Poland, for example. Of course, in a much greater diaspora after World War II, when the Soviets are going to force these ethnic cleansing of Germans. But so there is to a limited extent that kind of phenomenon in Germany.
Well, in the Italian case, we already have millions of Italians living outside of the Kingdom of Italy before the war. And as citizens, they're still liable to conscription. So in theory, well over a million Italians in America, but also in Latin America, should have been returning to Italy to serve. In reality, only about 300,000 do. But that's actually quite a lot. You know, it's a significant number of Italians who return, about 150,000 coming across the Atlantic, tens of thousands coming back from France or other European countries. There's even Italians in North Africa. So it is a global diaspora before the war. And it does bring up this very interesting question of citizenship. If you want to maintain your citizenship, in theory, you should be answering your call-up papers. Obviously, lots of them don't. And this does raise some very interesting questions. I would argue it's an interesting transition moment of identity that many of those Italian emigrants start to increasingly identify with their new host country during and after the war, who maybe previously had continued to really think of themselves as Italian and to maybe imagine returning to Italy one day. So it's a transitional moment in that history of kind of the global network of Italian emigrants.
And our last question for the panel. We heard about the national veterans groups. Were there any attempts in the three nations to form any kind of international veterans groups?
In the German case, there's quite a bit of cooperation between German and French veterans groups when it comes to tending cemeteries. And there is an international peace movement that includes veterans. Again, beyond that, I can't give you a whole lot of detail.
For the Americans, it's interesting that the American Legion itself is formed in Paris by American officers. In fact, Theodore Roosevelt's son is one of the founding members. And there will be a American Legion post maintained throughout most of the interwar period. And they do some work with the local veterans organizations. But on the whole, the United States, it doesn't go much further than that.
like everything else in the Italian case, it becomes very much politicized. So the major veterans associations become strongly nationalist quite quickly. And Italy is in this strange situation. It doesn't want to get too close necessarily to its former enemies, but it considers that it has been betrayed by its former allies. So the Italians certainly don't want to cozy up with the Americans because they blame Woodrow Wilson for not having got all of the extra land that they want. They're very resentful towards France and the UK as well. So it's quite an isolationist nationalist movement. The only sort of move towards more international cooperation is from the left-wing kind of proletariat leagues of veterans who are keen to kind of create a sort of internationalist movement of solidarity. But that is really crushed by the mid-1920s. As soon as Mussolini takes over, those organizations are completely violently suppressed.